Nothing in the desert ever happens as easily as it should, and the start to our 2014 desert adventure down the Connie Sue was not an exception to this rule. We needed to go west to get to Warburton and start the trek down the Connie Sue. However, the roads between Docker River and Warburton were closed, which meant we had to detour to the east back to Ayres Rock the Door before we could head south and then finally get going in a westerly direction. Before long, though, we'd made it to the bitumen.
So, we've made it to Yulara now. There was a little time back then when I heard something funny going on with the wheels of the T-van. The tyres sounded, something was dragging on them or something like that. So, Brett had a little look, and we've had a little look on the T-van website and have discovered that it's just the drum brakes.
Some civilization, a bit of a yummy lunch under our belt, we decided to get onto the Kalka track. Now, we've done the Kalka track before. We used to live out in Blackstone, and we used to use this road to travel from Yulara to Blackstone. We'd do our shopping in Yulara, fly out of Yulara to go and see family, so it was a pretty familiar route, and we're pretty excited to get back on it and relive the memories. Afternoon adventure with Jess, Layla and the dogs. Just going for a walk.
Hey Layla, you like going exploring?
Are you flying, Mum? Mind that Daddy will hold you. Yeah?
The following morning, we went out for another adventure before we got on the road and headed towards Rangers. On the Friday before our trip, I had to take the car into Alice Springs to get a new exhaust system fitted. Our exhaust that we had fitted, a 3-inch system, kept falling off the car, and our diff had also cracked, so we needed to get the rear diff welded up to hopefully limp us through the trip.
So Brett just checked the diff, how was it?
The diff was good. It was completely clean and dry and everything it needed to be, but there was a bit of dirt around one of the joins in the new exhaust, so I'll have to just make sure I nip it up tonight in case it's getting a little bit loose, because obviously there's moisture getting out there, but I don't know why there's moisture getting out there. Anyway.
Yeah. Enjoying the drive?
Really nice. Camped here a couple of times. Took off down there one day with Mum.
Going down into the valley. Yeah.
Under the current conditions that we've only literally just got just enough fuel, a margin of error about 5 litres, to make it all the way from Warburton to Cocklebiddy, 844 kilometres?
Yeah, that's there.
We refilled at Yulara and we got 265 k's done, and we're just approaching half of our fuel used on the car. So, see exactly what happens when we get to halfway and what exactly the damage is when we fill up at Warburton probably this afternoon.
Yep. Flowers! Flowers. Pretty flowers.
Just leaving after lunch on day two. Stopped and had a lunch just outside Wingalina. Got a door open somewhere. My door. Yes. Outside of Wingalina, we found a little, looks like greater camp. And we'll try and head on to Rangers now to see Chris Padgett and make plans for our recovery if we so need it. Catch up with Kay Balnaves, fill up our water, fill up our fuel, sort out whether we need more to carry more fuel, and get on our way.
I think you're going the wrong way.
This is where we come in.
Huh. I saw a car going back that way.
This is where we come in.
Oh, yeah. Sorry. My bad.
But we still could be going the wrong way.
No, because we turned around. You did a U. You're turning us around. This is the wrong way.
Let's see. I'm pretty confident.
I'm confident.
Everyone's confident. Who's right? If we didn't have GPSs, we could be lost for months here in this situation.
Well, we're not going the right way. We're going away from the sun, for starters, so we...
And then when I turn onto the road this way, just tell me.
Shut up. I feel lost. I'm sure you should have just drove straight.
So... is this coming from the same person who thought 10 minutes after we jumped in the car we're driving past our campsite again?
It's that this reset took off and said 30.00. So I knew that it reset and I'm like, oh, that's odd. And then when I just checked the fuel gauge to see how we're going, it's now gone up to just under a quarter of a tank used. So if that was correct, if the new reading's correct, we've got plenty of fuel again. So I don't know if it was playing up before or during lunch. It's played up on the restart. Not 100% sure. We'll have to wait until we get to Rangers and find out how our fuel economy is and exactly how much fuel we've used. How far is it from the junction of where the Connie Sue and the Len Beadell meet to Ilkirka Roadhouse?
174, I think.
Yeah. Because I was thinking if we do have real... And how far down is that junction? Down the Connie Sue?
Oh.
Is it far down?
I don't know where my blue folder is.
No. It's in the green bag there. Yeah. I was just wondering if fuel's going to be a big shortage for us when we fill up up here. If we could duck out to the Ilkirka and then keep going.
Yeah.
It's a 340-kilometer detour that I don't really want to do, but...
yes. Yes, it's dark. We didn't get to the roadhouse at Warburton in time. And I've heard about this place called Black's Lookout, and it's apparently down this track, we think, according to the GPS.
So this is our campsite, just outside of Warburton. We got in late last night and we couldn't get any into the roadhouse. Went and saw Chris and then come out here and set up. Had the tent down last night and we even got a few spots of rain. And just in the last stages of packing up. Noticed though when the dogs jumped out of the car last night, they must have tagged on the electric brakes and indicator plug on the back of the car there. It's pulled out. The plastic casing around it on the car side's a bit damaged, but it should be alright. I'm just gonna go back to Warburton and then tape it all up nice and tight. Warburton's only a few k's away. Just checking our level of water.
One's 3/4 full and one's half full.
So that's two nights and we've used that much of our water. We've got another 40 litres in these
blue drums. We've got another two 10 litre casks on this side of water. So that's an extra 60 litres. And then we've got another 50 litres stored in the car. We've used 35 litres in washing and that kind of thing in the last two nights. And we've used about 15 litres of our drinking water. So that's about 50 litres out of a total capacity of 140 on the camper, 50 in the car, and 60 in there. So we'll have to be a little bit more stringent on water, but I don't think that's going to be a huge thing. Biggest thing which hurts us, I guess, is having dogs, because, you know, between Ben and Binda, they'll drink, say, 2 litres a day, which is 4 litres. It's an extra 8 litres a day. Also, porridge is being a little bit hard to clean up, and the sink in the TV is really big, so I've been washing up already out of a saucepan, but just need to think of a few other ways to cut back on our water usage. But I'm sure we'll be fine. But I guess it just limits how long we can really plan to stay on the Connie Sue to give us a couple of days breathing space of water if we were to break down. Turning onto the Connie Sue.
Ooh. So we just pulled up in the nick of time. Just hovering over the bonnet. This was a track that we shouldn't have took. But we didn't really see it till we got round the corner.
In Warburton, we ended up picking up another 20 litre jerry can for diesel. And we're keen to get onto the Connie Sue and see what the adventure was going to be about. So here in Wide Angle, at our campsite for the night, just off the Connie Sue Highway, we're about 80 or 90. So Pa's made our mab flaps for us, and it's a bit of a joke that anything that Pa makes has too many bolts and too many everything in it. But you can see here the mud flap out here has ended up catching on something, and it's bent the whole bar on here. Back. Instead of just breaking the mud flap off, it's actually just bent it backwards and bent all the metal up in underneath that holds the rebar in place. So the first bit of damage for the Connie Sue.
Lovely singing, Layla. In the early 1960s, Len Beadell, wife Anne, and 5-month-old daughter Connie Sue started from Warburton and bushbashed in Len's Land Rover 300 kilometres south to the rough location of where the Anne Beadell would meet the Connie Sue Highway, now known as Neil Junction. When Connie was seen just north of Neil Junction standing for the first time in her T-chest bassinet, it was decided that the road from Warburton to Rawlina would be called after her, the Connie Sue Highway.
So here at Harknest Gorge, car's been really heavy on fuel so far. 20.6 is what it's reading, so I'm assuming that'll be about 22.6, 23 litres per 100. So it just really questions whether we can do too many detours off the side of the road to make it to Cocklebitty or not. Obviously, as we keep going though, we're hoping that it gets better and better on fuel economy as we use more water, eat more food. The fuel itself weighs less. But we'll see how we go. All in all, car's going good, camper's towing well, dogs are going well, Layla's going well, and it's been a really
so far on the Connie Sue. It's been probably more scenic than I thought it was going to be. The track's just a normal kind of road. Nothing to be worried about. A few little washways, a few branches kind of coming across, but if you take your time, nothing that's going to scratch your car or do any damage. But I guess we've been hitting things a little bit harder than I would have liked, just because I'm trying to get some better fuel economy. So it's a bit of a balancing act. Crawl along at 30, get crappy fuel economy, slowing down for absolutely everything, speeding back up, but just trying to walk that tightrope. So Layla and Jess are off exploring the canyon, and I'm gonna make us some morning tea. Got the jet boil, got the Timsy bags, got Jess's tea bags. Light him up. Use this as a bit of a lid. Not bad.
There's a lot of washaways in this section, and from the other angle that looks like it could be a little bit nasty. So we just got out and checked it. Car's still getting on some nice angles. Can't really tell on the video. Anyway.
There is a bit of a backstory to the Connie Sue Highway. Now, Jason, Stephanie, Jess and I had always discussed how we wanted to go down the Connie Sue and make it from the desert to the ocean. Unfortunately, Jason and Steph weren't able to make it on this trip, but we're keen to do it with them in the front of our memory banks.
Just pulled up for lunch. We're going towards a lookout area, but we couldn't make it. Bluff area. We come a guts from the second sand dune, and we didn't want to push it because of just fuel consumption worries. So we pulled up here for lunch. I just let the tyres down a little bit too, as we can see. It's fairly sandy, the track, and very corrugated, so I thought a bit less tyre pressure wouldn't be a problem. We've just left from lunch, honestly about 2 minutes down the road, and we've come across this water, and it seems to be going good. So I'm going to empty some 20 litre drinking water drums I have in there from home into our T-van water supplies and fill up the other 20 litres just to make sure that we've got enough water to get us home. We're going to give Layla a little splash in a bucket and get her a bit fresher. So all our excitement of this water has quickly faded into something different. That is the colour of the water, and we've had a look in the tank and that's the colour of all the water in the tank. So we're now debating whether A, we can fill the dog's water up, or B, whether we should even bath Layla in that.
Oh, I might as well be doing this under the actual tap. That's $12 I just spent.
Well, I was pretty keen to get in on the action.
Ha, I got you.
Is that mud running down your back?
How dirty I am.
I'd also like to see the water come in and see how clean it is. Ah, she's in!
Fish!
Here at Point Sandercock for our second night's camping on the Connie Sue. And as you can see, a very nice backdrop. We didn't end up making it down to Yeo Chasm. Had a fairly big day in the car to get to here. So Jess is just making the fire. We've got the camper set up for how we're having it tonight. Got the cheese and the biscuits under the towel. And the sun is just going down behind the Prado, so we'll probably stay here for two nights.
planned for a walk in the morning and a walk in the evening to avoid the midday sun. However, in hindsight, we probably should have gone for a walk in the middle of the day and sheltered in one of the nice cool caves that was overlooking our camp.
So, it's nice and windy here at Cockburn? Point Cockburn?
Sandercock Point.
Jess is just digging a hole to escape from the heat and wind because it is quite hot and windy today.
So this is the start of our new house.
And this is the banana cake that she's making. It's going to go in the hole. I'm a little bit annoyed that there's a fire going because it's honestly hot and I can feel the hot fire, but that's alright. Layla's just found Amy. And let's see if Layla will do a trick. Ready, Layla? Ha! Banana! Anya. Layla was practicing being Lion King a little bit earlier. So, we're just on a rest day today.
A lot of little caves and big caves actually around here. Oh, Daddy! Oh, I just got a spot of rain.
Oh, it's raining.
Where?
You're right.
All right. Yeah. In there. Oh, there we go. There's the climber. She's coming out.
Here you come.
Cool.
Oh, where are we going, Layla? In here? Oh.
It's a bit hard, Mum.
Well, Mummy's got to get through there too.
Oh, she made it, Mum.
Huh?
Oh, what's over there, Layla?
Oh, what is it? More cave. Wow. Woo.
Well, Mummy, I think we've got to go up now.
Up.
Layla. So, we're going to do the tyres up by sight this morning because that one at the front is sitting at about 24 and it should have about 3.5 blocks sitting on the ground. 1, 2, 3.5, yep. This one here is also sitting at 24, but the belly has bowed out a lot. And we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.5 blocks sitting on the ground. I'm just worried about this tagging rocks and doing some damage, so I'm going to pump it up by sight so it's got 3.5 sitting on there and just see what that does for our ride. I don't know if it's going to affect it and make it a little bit more bumpy as we go over the corrugations or what ends up happening.
We really enjoyed our time at Point Sandercock. We had a good chance to rest and recover and were eager to see what else the Connie Sue Highway had to offer.
Two different galleries. Really special place, I think. Just coming in Neil Junction, is it? Please do not collect firewood within 10 kilometres of junction. Turn 50.
Feels going a lot better today. 20.7. It's come down by almost 0.5 litres per 100.
Intersection of Len Beadell Highway and Connie Sue Highway. It's a bit exciting. Pulled up at Neil Junction Reserve camping spot.
Reds. Moments of truth. Will we have enough diesel in order to make it all the way to Cofflebitty? Or will we have to go east to Elkirka?
Careful over. Eat munching on some Laughing Cow soft cheese. And I'm gonna get to making some lunch for a change.
We got 73 litres in, which gave
73
litres.
How did you know?
Because I knew how much went into each dairy.
I thought they were made on, like, we had 10 20s and 2 5s. So where'd the 3 come from?
Each 20 had 21 litres in it.
Okay.
So we got 73 litres in, which means we've still got 10 litres free, which gave us a fuel consumption of 19.57 litres per 100, which means from here on we have a range of 800 kilometres at 20 litres per 100, so we should have around 20 litres in the bag when we get to Cocklebitty.
So is the computer reading high, or yeah, I suppose it's an average? So that's an average. It was 19, 18 at the start. Went up to 21 or so.
So, and given the track's got a lot better, we should have more than enough to get down. If it stays like this, and it looks like we're out of the Juni country from here on in as we hit the Nullarbor and that. So, pretty confident that there's no need to get any extra fuel. We'll just keep on our way. Oi! That's graffiti.
That's not good.
We should check to make sure we have enough of the next supply. Just checking to make sure we've got enough of everything before we avoid our trip to Elkirka Roadhouse. Oh, Jess, we've only got 3 more treats left. Is that enough to get us through?
Beadell and Connie Sue Junction, called Neil Junction. This way is Len Beadell. No, this way is Connie Sue. This way is Len Beadell. So, we've just come down the Connie Sue. We're still heading south. And in a week or a week and a half, we'll be at this spot again, travelling west to east to Elkirka along the Len Beadell.
We were very glad not to be having to make a little detour through to Elkirka Roadhouse, so we signed the visitor's book at the Neil Junction and continued on our way.
So we've found an additional bit of unexpected water that we didn't think we'd come across, a couple of water tanks. As you can see, the skies might fill them up very soon. So Layla and Jess is doing a bit of a load of washing. Water left in this one. And 3/4 left in the other one. So now we're up to 4.5 full again.
Here we go. Aren't you lucky?
Oh, it's very lucky. And the water's not even near the same colour as the last time I had a bath, Mum.
So we've gone from filling up the waters to cheese and biscuits. Layla had a bath and that inspired all of us.
Right into the new breakaway.
Starting to perhaps get a little bit lighter, whether temporarily or for good. The red colour is definitely not as intense as what it's been.
Particularly sections.
Mm.
It does look like BHP has been here. Wow. Oh, so bizarre. Oh, yucky. Camel.
That's where the dogs will be.
Oh, no. Look at that. Oh, it's a bit sandy. Enough for the edges.
Hill breakaways were by far the most spectacular place we'd seen thus far along the Connie Sue, and it had a really interesting feel camping there. With the salt around and the lack of prickles, taking our shoes off and walking around made it really feel like we were camping in a beach kind of setting. It was a really nice change up from the red dusty desert. Having a cruisy morning, getting ready to go, just packing up the kitchen. Just wanted to point out how lucky we've been. We've had this cloud cover over the last couple of days, and as you can see, we've got no shade here. Sitting in like a salt pan with no trees around, just barren. So if it wasn't for the cloud cover, we'd be in just direct sunlight the whole time. This is the second day that we've had this cloud cover that's kind of saved us. It's just been really, really lucky, especially with our fox wing broken and without that shade. We've been super lucky for the cloud cover. Ah! Wow!
That pinnacle thing, just on my way down, all very shaley stuff. It's amazing, all this is all broken down, and back to the car.
Left the Neil breakaways, the track really started to improve. There were less and less of the washaways that we'd come across on the Warburton end of the track, and things really started to speed up. Our fuel economy improved a lot as the sandy country died out. However, the scenery died off a little bit too on the second half. On the Warburton end, there was always a breakaway or something around to check out. Once we started to hit station country and get close to the Nullarbor, it really flattened out and the scenery, I guess, died off a bit.
Still had to be a street art around here. Layla.
So we've just come off the Junjunjara, obviously community used route, and we're back onto the Connie Sue. The Junjunjara road looks like it goes over towards Kalgoorlie, so obviously that's where they're heading for supplies and that kind of thing. And we're back on a bit of a goat track. I didn't know that we were going to hit this kind of goat track again. So probably just have to swap drivers in the near future.
After pulling fuel economies as high as 27 litres per 100, when Jess and I spied that we were running a flat 16, we were pretty excited about the situation.
So we've crossed onto station country and there's a bit of water on the road. We've seen our first cow.
First bunny rabbit.
First
of the trip.
Bunny rabbit, first cow. Now we're just waiting for emu.
That's nearly Australian. Yeah, we've got to find some emus for later. This would be emu.
And we're getting within a couple of 100 kilometres of the coast, if we're not already within 100 or so, 200 or so kilometres.
Look at him.
Trying to bite daddy. Look at his little legs.
Look at baby, you're cool.
A shingle back behind us. We started opening gates and I don't think we really knew how many gates we were going to be opening.
So we just come up to a sign. It points us in the right direction because there's another track going out that way.
But it was a constant battle opening and closing the gates.
From Rawlina, we had planned to travel south through Arubidi Station, but a sign on the first gate denied entry. This meant we had to travel east to Hague and then down a public access road through station country. The station country was filled with dog baits, so we were forced to travel late into the night until we got to Cocklebiddy. As it grew darker, the roads became plagued with roos, wallabies, rabbits and gates.
Some of the old farm gates were pretty complex to get put back together for us.
There's one more gate before the highway. Air highway. 954, so I better get out and open it. Coming out of... onto the air highway. Bitumen.
Black top. This is weird.
First time since Yalara.
So I've made it into Cocklebiddy really late. It's probably about 11 o'clock now. Set up the tent for the girls in the camper. So they're in there. Jess is in there putting Layla to bed. Now that we've made it back to civilization, get to enjoy a real meal after weeks of bush camping. Getting out the old backcountry tikka masala. So I'll sit out here. Get done.
So this is a track down to Twilight Cove. Apparently it's, 38 kilometres or so, but at the roadhouse they say it would take two and a half hours and it gets pretty rough with a bit of low range driving and narrow tracks type thing, so it's going to be interesting. Brett's driving this morning.
Can't wait.
Again, greedy guts for the driving. And you can see he's a bit of a lead foot. Hey, that was just 16.4 when it dropped. Layla's got a drink bottle.
A lot softer dune. Tires down, I'd say, on that one on the way out.
by deflation comes with beach territory, but just dropping the airbag pressures because it's really rough. Before the trip, I rerouted the airbag valves to the back here because previously they were up in under the wheel arch in a really weird spot. So at least when I need to let them down or do them back up, they're quite easy to get to.
Our first glimmer of beach, and we've just come to this sign of hazardous descent.
As we drove down the hazardous descent, we chuckled quietly to ourselves, thinking quite smugly that it wasn't that bad a track at all, but we weren't to know of the nature of the track a little bit further on, where it turned into what I'd almost call single trail.
Get out of the way of the trees. Wow. It is an effort to get down here. Leaving our mark.
Onto the beach marks the end of an epic adventure that we were talking about with Your Trip Right crew 6 years previous. Now, as we pulled onto that beach, Your Trip Right hadn't been conceptualized, but we knew we were on the brink of something a little bit special. Bender. Oh, she's just snuck through. No geocache.
Yeah.
So we're still geo broke?
Yeah.
There's been a development.
I found it! Quick, come over here!
Oh, geo rich.
Oh, look at the goodies in there.